Merry Christmas. There you go. All right, how many of you have your Christmas trees up already? Wow, is that all? My goodness. But those of you who have, good for you. You're aware that we have just a few more Sundays together with you, and we're going to be able to be home for Christmas, and we're looking forward to that. But because we are able to go home this last weekend for Thanksgiving, our intent was, my wife, usually it's been our tradition to buy the Christmas tree when we are getting real Christmas trees right after Thanksgiving. Well, we don't do that anymore. We have a fake one, and we have for about 25 years, mainly because of allergies. That's not fun, but hey, it's good stuff. And we got home, though, without the Christmas tree that we've used for the past 25 years. So what's the first thing that we did? We went shopping for a Christmas tree. Yes, that's right. And we upgraded a little bit. We got one of those pre-lighted ones. That's cool. And it's standing in our home at in Tucson, and we had a wonderful time with our family. And our next-door neighbors, we had Thanksgiving meal together with them. So it was a wonderful time. I'm sure you've had a great time this week. As we were driving home, oh my grief, how many people left the Los Angeles basin to go east? I really don't know, but we found a little bit of it out. I thought coming back Saturday early afternoon, the traffic would not be bad. Not so. It took us 2 hours to get from Palm Springs to here. And oh my goodness. Well, so people want to get out, but they want to come back in. Doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but I suppose we kind of get it, don't we? Well, this is the first Sunday of Advent. It's time to look afresh, look new at what God has made available to us that we celebrate during these next 4 weeks. Have you ever noticed that God does not ask us to do anything that he hasn't already modeled for us? Whether it be self-sacrifice, whether it be how to truly love, how to truly give, whatever it might be, he never asks us to do anything that he has not already modeled for us and that he does not stand ready through his Holy Spirit to enable us to do now. Well, the Christmas or Advent account is a profound evidence of God's outward, should I say, initiating focus. There is no parallel in any other religion of the world for what we celebrate these next 4 weeks. All other religions are systems by which man reaches out to God. Man decides who God is, basically creates God in his or her own image, and decides how we can please that deity, whomever it is and whatever it looks like. Every other religion on the planet is a story of man, humankind, trying to initiate, trying to get in contact with someone or something greater than himself. Today, it's just become kind of the word of the hour. We don't reach out to God, we reach out to the universe. How many times have you heard that? Just put it out to the universe. Because we as a community, we as a culture have virtually rejected the reality that there is a God who initiated, who created it all, and who loves us, and who has initiated a relationship with us. Only Christianity worships the God who reaches out to man. Christmas itself is a profound testimony to how far God has gone in his pursuit of us. The story of Christmas becomes even more amazing when we realize that it was actually what we are celebrating in these next 4 weeks. This Christmas is actually God's plan B. It was not his original intent. It was not his original desire. Of course, because he is omniscient and he is eternal, he is not restricted to time. He lives in the eternal present. He knew what was going to come, but it was not his ultimate plan. It was not his ultimate desire. This thing we call Christmas, it's his plan B. It was not his first choice. But Christmas, as we know it, speaks to the extent he was willing to go for me and for you. Love compels us to do some pretty amazing things, doesn't it? And his love for his creation compelled him to do what we celebrate today, what we know as Christmas. But actually, it was his plan B. But in order to appreciate the extraordinary nature of plan B a little bit more, let's look back at plan A for a moment. Would you open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 2? Genesis chapter 2. Very familiar account. I'm only going to read the first couple of verses, but we're really going to look at this story in detail all the way through chapter 3 of Genesis. I will refer to bits and pieces of it, and you'll be very familiar with it. But would you stand, please, in honor of the reading of God's Word? And I'm going to start Genesis chapter 2. I'm going to read verses 8 and 9. Genesis chapter 2, verse 8. Then the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he placed the man he had made. The Lord God made all sorts of trees grow up from the ground, trees that were beautiful and that produced delicious fruit. And in the middle of the garden, he placed the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The account is very familiar to us. We're going to perhaps take a little bit different look at it today. Father, as we look at your word, as we look at the beginning of all that we call humanity, human culture, human history, the human condition, as we look at it today in light of what you have revealed to us in the pages of what we call the Bible, Holy Spirit, would you open our eyes perhaps a little bit more completely than ever before? May we hear from you today the account that we have heard, depending on how long we have lived, how many Christmases we have celebrated it, we have undoubtedly heard it for that many years, that many times. And our tendency is to become anesthetized, almost numb. It doesn't hardly even move us anymore, except the nice sugary parts of it. Would you, Holy Spirit, help us to see through your eyes what plan B means and what your plan A was. Help us now, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated. God's plan A. Let's look at it for a few moments. What did it include? Well, even in these two verses that we read, it obviously included an idyllic setting, a garden with no weeds, we read later in chapter 3. A garden would, how many of you have gardened? How many would you consider yourselves gardeners today? My name is Farmer. Not a gardener. Got the brownest thumb in history. Oh my goodness. I can kill just about anything. When we went back to Kentucky for seminary, if you have ever lived in that part of our great nation, gardening is a thing, a major thing. There are complete television stations dedicated to gardening. And I had always wanted to give it a shot, so I gave it a shot. And there are two basic things that grow that I thought I might be able to grow and that I would also like to eat. One was Silver Queen corn, corn on the cob. The other was tomatoes. So I got I rented a rototiller, and I rototilled way too big a plot, and planted rows of corn, planted, I think, 8 tomato plants. If you have ever gardened, you know how foolish that is. 8 tomato plants for a family of 5. Only one of whom really likes tomatoes. You grow so many tomatoes, all you're doing is trying to get find people who are dumb enough to take them from you. The corn. Now, of course, in Kentucky, you don't have to irrigate, you don't have to water, because rain comes relatively regularly. But what also comes very regularly in any garden, after you plant the seeds that you want, there are seeds already there, whether you know it or not, that you don't want. And weeds start to grow up. The corn stalks started to grow out of the ground to where I could see them, and the weeds started to grow up. And I realized, you know, one of the reasons I have never gardened is because I don't like to weed. So I decided, I had made the corn rows far enough apart that I could push a lawnmower in between them. So my weeding entailed pushing a lawnmower through and mowing the weeds down, and couldn't get between the stalks, so there were several rows of corn growing up, and the weeds were growing as long as they were in line with the corn, but the rest of it looked like a beautiful lawn. Weeds. Can you imagine a garden without weeds? Apparently, in God's plan A, there were no weeds. Can you imagine? There were no thorns and there were no thistles. So Arizona did not exist. I weeded Friday. I still have a thorn in my thumb that I have not been able to dig out with my tweezers and needle. If anybody doesn't mind listening to a grown man scream, I would love you to try and get this out of me. Thorns and thistles. We cannot imagine world without it. But God's plan A, they didn't exist. Sounds pretty cool, doesn't it? It was an idyllic setting. It had an automatic watering system, and it wasn't rain. It was what we call today a vapor canopy. It was kind of the greenhouse effect, and all scientists today agree on it. They don't agree how long ago it was, but they all agree that at one point the globe, our Earth, was circled by a vapor canopy. There was a uniform climate all around the globe, and it never rained. The Bible tells us it didn't rain until the flood. Noah had never seen it rain when he built the ark. Hey, you got to be kidding me. It didn't need to rain because every evening the dew fell, the temperature got down below the dew point, and dew fell so heavily that it watered everything. And there was basically a subtropical vegetation that covered the planet. So not only were there no weeds, you didn't have to water. This is God's plan A. Their food sources were all naturally occurring. For Adam and Eve, our first parents, God created a system where they would not have to till the soil. They would not have to fight the weeds. All they would have to do was pick the fruit. That's God's plan A. productivity without sweat, managing plant and animal life, and naming animals, and picking fruit. God's plan A. God's plan A also included perfect relationships. Adam and Eve's relationship with God. Nothing was hindering it. They walked in the cool of the evening, chatted with one another, and even though God, of course, knew what they were thinking before the thought passed through their mind, he loved to hear their voice. And they talked with him. Their relationship with God was perfect. Their relationship with animals was perfect. Can you imagine? I think the only perfect relationship with an animal I've ever had is with my dog right now. Cats, no. We're cats, you know. They're the boss, not us, that's for sure. The dog comes the closest to it. Husband and wife relationships were perfect. There was no shame, and there was no guilt between the husband and wife. There were no power plays. This is God's plan A, guys. This is the way God designed it to be right from the beginning. There was perfect communication. Adam and Eve communicated daily with God, walking in the cool of the evening with him, conversing. I come to the garden alone. You love that song? I get that picture so often in my mind. And that's the idyllic communion of my spirit with his spirit. But that's the way it was, perfectly. Daily communication with them. Communication was perfect with the animals. I mean, Dr. Doolittle, that's just fantasy, right? God's plan A, apparently, animals talked. How do we know that? Come on, think through the scriptural account. How do we know that animals talked? The serpent, the snake, talked with Adam and Eve. How many times have you wished your animal could talk to you? And I'm not talking your husband, wives, okay? But there was perfect communication with spouse, too. I don't know if you've ever seen it this way, but we see in Scripture where Adam actually wrote Eve a poem. What was the poem? Remember, God created Eve, presented her to Adam, and what did Adam say? And this is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. The first love poem. That's kind of cool. I can't write a poem for nothing. But there was perfect communication. Wow, what just happened? There was free will, of course. The will to respect. We had the freedom, the choice to respect and to trust and to love and to be responsible for what God had trusted to us. This was the world for which God designed his plan A. That's why we're so discontented with what we have now. Because what we have now has fallen so far short of that. What went wrong? Well, of course, it was free will. But the fact that God gave us free will, knowing full well what the outcome would be, is some of the most profound evidence of God's unselfish other-oriented, outward-focused toward his human creation. God cared more that we would have the opportunity to love him, because without free will, there is no love. If I have no choice but to be good for him, to obey him, if I have no other choice, then my actions are not love. Love is freely given. God cared more that we would have the opportunity to love than he dreaded the pain of our rejection and the necessity of plan B. So what is plan B? As God's plan A unraveled, we see in the account there are three places in from where we started in Genesis chapter 2 through the end of Genesis chapter 3. There are at least three places where we see plan B begin to take over. And of course, we understand from the New Testament that God's plan B, what we're going to look at here in a moment, what we call, what we know as Christmas today, and God in his omniscience, all-knowing, and his eternality, there is no past, present, there is no past or future with him. He lives in the eternal present. He knew what would happen before he created anything. And the New Testament tells us that because he knew that, because he knew that plan A was going to fizzle, that he set plan B in motion even before he created anything that he created. But what about plan B? Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. We see that in plan B, humankind had to start dealing with an awareness of shame that begged to be covered. Verse 7 says, so they, Adam and Eve, strung fig leaves together around their hips to cover themselves. This is the first failed attempt at what we call theologically atonement. The word atonement in the original language is kafar, K-A-F-A-R, kafar. And it literally means to cover. And this was the very first attempt of God's creation, his human creation, to cover their failure, their shame, their guilt. We'll see in a moment what God had to do in response to it. But continuing on with this plan B, we see in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, that we see the promise of God of a man, a human, who would defeat the serpent, Satan. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, and theologically it's called the proto-evangelium, which means proto means first. Evangelium means good news. This is the first, very first recorded instance where God begins to reveal his plan B. Let me remind you, and I quote, from now on, God said, you, Satan, and the woman, Eve, will be enemies. And your offspring and her offspring will be enemies. Of course, Jesus ultimately is the one whom God was looking forward to here, but he was also describing you and me, the enemies of Satan himself. God goes on, he says, he, the offspring of Eve, Jesus, will crush your head, Satan, and you will strike his heel. Here is the very first mentioned plan B. It's the very first mention of what we call Christmas today, where God stepped out of eternity and into time. He took on human flesh and he walked among us for 33 years in Jesus of Nazareth, the seed of Eve. The very first mention, very first promise, if you will, that God is going to provide a way. Plan A, we rejected. But plan B, God makes available to you and me even today. And part of that plan B was that he would become one of us. You, Jesus, you, the seed of Eve, will crush the serpent's head. In other words, you will destroy his ultimate power over creation. He'll hit you on the heel. You'll die, but you won't stay dead. The very first plan B mentioned in Scripture of Christmas and then the resurrection, Easter, the cross, and the resurrection, all here in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. Going on with plan B. God provided the first covering for sin. Remember, the first effective covering for sin. Adam and Eve tried to cover their own shame and guilt with the fig leaves. They tried to kafar themselves, to cover themselves. God said, apparently, no, not enough. Not enough. Genesis 3:21, and the Lord God made clothing from animal skins for Adam and his wife. If he made clothing from animal skins, what had to happen to the animals? They had to die. See, this ties all the way to Romans chapter 6, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death. Something has to die to cover my sin. The very first provision of God in plan B to cover my nakedness and my shame and yours was when God took the first life. It's the first recorded death. It's the death of whatever animal it was. God killed that animal, shed its blood, and with the skin of that animal covered Adam and Eve. By the way, if you've ever wondered why, if you go into chapter 4, why did God reject Cain's offering and accepted Abel's offering? How did Cain know that he was supposed to offer an animal? He didn't. He was a farmer. Yes, he did. He knew the account of how God had to cover, the only way to cover sin was death. So Cain knew, but he rejected it. That was free of charge. Think about that one. So God provided the first covering for sin. This is plan B. This is Christmas as we know it today. God's plan B, Christmas, shows us at least three things. First, his plan B shows us just how far we've fallen from plan A. When relationships went from perfect relationships, open, honest, vulnerable, without guilt and shame, to all of a sudden covered with guilt and shame. How many of you in this past week, and I'm not looking at you and I'm not asking you to raise your hand, but how many of you suffered pain because of broken relationships during a time that's supposed to be all about relationships, all about family? The numbers tell us that from now through Christmas, really even through New Year's, it's the highest rate of suicide of any time of the year. It is the most difficult time of year for many people. And those people, the reason it's painful is because of broken, guilty, shameful relationships. But God has a plan B to deal with it. He offers us hope. But before we can really appreciate what he offers us, we need to realize how far we've fallen from plan A. Second thing plan B reveals to us is the extent to which God was willing to go to bring us back into relationship with himself. What was it going to cost God? When we rejected, when our first parents rejected plan A, as perfect as it was, what did it cost? What was it going to cost God? This plan B. It was going to cost his only son. It was going to require that he see his only son step out of the perfection and absolute sovereignty, authority, and power of heaven in the triune Godhead, step out of that perfection, take on human flesh, and walk among us. And what does Paul say in Philippians chapter 2? He turned his back on all that was rightfully his as God, and he took on the very form of a slave, of a human, even to the point of death. That's what it cost God. Plan B was excruciatingly costly to God, but it shows how much he loves you and me. Does your celebration, will your celebration of Christmas this year include an awareness of how much it costs God to offer you plan B? And have you accepted his plan B? I'm sure there are more things that we could draw from this, but the last one that I'll share with you is plan B shows us the immeasurable value that God places on you and me. For him to do what we celebrate him doing, that's love. Christmas is plan B. We tend to really get wrapped up. Why can't it be perfect like this? Especially when parts of our family step out of plan A and it just ain't perfect like it's supposed to be. But God. But plan B offers to you and me without cost the kind of relationship for him, with him, for which we were created. Are you enjoying that today? Don't miss it this Christmas season.